Dear subscribers, as you know, we shared many information for you, and we are studying very hard to find current news for you. However, I cannot use this channel for future. Please follow our new channel called As Daily News Report and watch our video to support us. Link in description. Also, you can reach the video we shared on Daily News Report by clicking on the top right button. We highly recommend watching, subscribing, and sharing. We will continue to share some news on this channel, but we take precautions against some situations for future. Thank you for supporting us.
So we now see that the United States, who claims to be fighting ISIS, although now there's reports, all kinds of reports about how the intelligence was played down, how they were given support by the West. I mean, and we see them, you know, supposedly fighting ISIS, taking out a secular government. When they tell us radical Islam is the problem, they've been taking out secular governments in the Middle East for the last decade. And so it makes no sense. There's no sense whatsoever. I look at Russia as basically wanting to stand up for one of its allies, stand up for a naval port, although small naval port it has on the Mediterranean. And quite frankly, also to they don't want to see ISIS take over the entire Middle East, and that's what's been happening. And you've seen it just pick up momentum ever since the Arab Spring started, which is, at least in my opinion, based on facts that I've seen, was something that was started by the State Department in the United States. Certainly financed and funded by the Western, by Western countries. And, you know, you can't help think it's like this British colonial destabilization model, so they can further exercise control over all the different, you know, natural gas, oil, and all the other things that come out of that region.
Now, let me ask you, I mean, you hear it on the corporate media, you hear it from the government. They're telling us, oh, we have to stop this, you know, dictator, this terrorist. We have to stop him from poisoning his own people with chemical weapons. Do you think that's what it's all about, or do you think it's something else?
Well, I think it has absolutely nothing to do that. I think actually more what it has to do so is, in many ways, a covert war that's already started against the Russians, against the Iranians, and really against this Eastern super bloc that we see rising both in China, Russia, and in Iran. So I think that's one of the reasons we're seeing, for example, Israel going against Syria, and empowering ISIS. Same thing with the United States. Same thing with, you know, with England. Same thing with France. I mean, they're all doing the same thing. And I think that's what it really is. It's this proxy war, like we see in Ukraine, that is taking place. You know, Russia's in a position where they're clearly not tolerating it anymore. What I've seen and what I've heard is they've already sent in special forces into Syria, as well as, you know, all setting up an airfield, all kinds of other military equipment that's going in there. And again, I think the biggest thing to look at here, Dave, is that we're told here by the corporate media, but specifically by so-called conservatives and Republicans and even select Democrats as well, that radical Islam is the problem. Yet these are the same people that have systematically dismantled every secular government in the Middle East and have emboldened the theocrats and the Islamist terrorists, have really emboldened them, and emboldened them to the extent of potentially financing them and arming them. You know, to me, I've said all along, I think eventually groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda could potentially be used against the Russians and the Chinese.
Now, I mean, we see all this happening, and you know, the United States was saying, oh, we're not going to speak to Russia. We're not going to, you know, have contact with them, with the military. And now we see a complete 180 where Obama is now going to talk to Putin about Syria. I mean, why do you think that's happening?
Well, Obama is fundamentally weak, like him or not. I mean, the truth is he's not in control of anything, but he is seen as being incompetent and weak. And he once again, you know, Putin, whether people like him or not, he's decisive and he takes bold action. And that's why his approval ratings in Russia are have been at record highs. unlike Obama. And so I think that, you know, here again, Obama is caving, and ultimately Putin's going to win. Putin's won in Ukraine. Putin will win in Syria. I mean, and that's just what's going on. Now, the Republicans running for office, they think that more conflict and more confrontation is the way to go instead of diplomacy. Obama's not even the diplomat. I mean, if you look at the Iranian deal, which I support the Iranian deal in the sense that I don't want war with Iran, and if this deal temporarily allows that, so be it. The sociopaths and psychopaths that are beholden to the military industrial complex, they want conflict. They want war. And interestingly enough, you hear them citing this in defense of Israel, which I don't have a problem with Israel, Dave, but to be told is that, you know, less than 2%, I believe, of the U.S. population are Jewish. We need to, in my opinion, focus on American national interests, and I don't believe going to war with any of these countries represents our national interests.
I agree with you. I mean, what do you think if Putin calms the situation down? What do you think the U.S.'s next move would be in this area?
Well, I think this goes beyond, you know, a lot of people think World War II is coming. Certainly it harkens back to World War I, where you have all of these alliances taking place. You have a tremendous amount of incompetence on the world stage as far as quote unquote leadership goes. But I think this really comes down to economic, to potentially economic wars, not currency wars so much. As I think were, you know, people were believing that it was a currency war that was taking place with when China was devaluing its currency. I don't believe that to be the case. I think instead of what we're seeing, Dave, is more so, like I said earlier, Eastern countries coming together to directly challenge the United States and the Western and the West controlling really global finance. And I think that they're using the military in certain ways to be able to exercise more and influence more economically. So I think, you know, ultimately this goes down in an economic manner. It could lead to war. I mean, there's no doubt about it. I mean, we're, you know, we're one miscalculated step away. I shouldn't say we, I should say the people that run the US government or even those in Russia are one calculated step away from this breaking out into a regional or global war. But I think it goes down economically, personally.
Okay. I wanted to come back here to the United States and talk about the Fed and, you know, how Yellen was out there and they decided not to raise the interest rates once again. Now, when we see this, it kind of sends up red, you know, flags and the red flashing light goes off saying, well, is the economy actually in recovery or are they telling us that it really isn't in recovery and this is why they can't raise the interest rates? I mean, why do you think they didn't raise the interest rates at this point?
Well, I think that the fundamental reason, I mean, first off, the balance sheet of the Fed, the money manipulation of the Fed is a complete horror show. Are there parts of the U.S. economy that are recovering? Yes, they are. I'm on the front lines of this economy every single day. Now, why are they recovering? They're recovering because of record low interest rates that are taking place. I think that is the biggest fuel of this economy. And really the expansion of continued expansion of credit. That's why the economy, we've seen some growth in the economy. I think that with that said, I think that the Fed is not raising rates because what we're seeing here is a collaboration of central banks around the world. And the best thing to look at this for its indicator has been how really we've seen the Bank of England, we've seen the Federal Reserve, we've seen the European Central Bank, we've seen the Bank of China, the People's Bank of China, all in this Russian roulette of dollar devaluation. So the way the global economy works today, it's in essence almost like a mutually assured destruction that they used to have in the Cold War with nuclear weapons. Today it's mutually assured economic destruction, where one country's default or one country's decision to dump treasuries on the open market could potentially lead to a daisy chain of economic collapse. So they've come together and they're coordinating, I believe, the stimulus. And I think the Fed really, I mean, look, I think most people that are listening, Dave, will agree that America's lost its sovereignty in so many different ways. It's lost its sovereignty economically as well. So to believe the Fed is acting in the best interest of just the United States, I think is complete ignorance. I think they're acting in the state, in more so in this global concerted effort.
Yeah, I think they're working in the best interest for themselves and, you know, keeping themselves afloat and not so much for the people, because we see a huge amount of wealth being transferred up to the central banking society and not to the people whatsoever. And Fabian, let me ask you, I mean, we're seeing the markets, they're continually fluctuating. I mean, we see Asia up and down, I mean, huge highs, huge lows. We see it in Europe. And today it looks like the market is down again. It goes up, it comes straight down. And if we go back 6 months, we're down like about 14, 1500 points around there. I mean, what do you see happening in the market right now?
Well, I mean, I think that with respect to China will ultimately enter a depression. They've expanded credit the most since 2008. It's an absolute credit bubble that's going to go down in flames. The question is when. Personally, when it comes to the stock market, I mean, the stock market theoretically needs two things to grow. One of them is economic growth, and the other one is an expansion of credit. Well, the economic growth has really been barely existent. The expansion of credit has been astronomical, and I think I don't really see them stopping this anytime soon. That's why I continue to hold to my forecast that I think the Dow Jones will hit 20,000. And again, that's not me being bullish on the stock market. That's me just proudly proclaiming that the fundamental fact that the markets, every market, is 100% rigged. Same thing with the real estate market. The no money down loans are back in style. You have a bankruptcy that happened last week, not a problem. You got low credit score below 550, not a problem. FHA is giving loans out like crazy. In fact, they're just in the process of rewriting rules with banks so that banks will offer even more FHA loans. So, I mean, this is all that they have left. It's often cited that, or often said that, the Feds run out of weapons. They have nothing left. I disagree with that. I think that they're just going from using rifles and tanks to now using Predator drones and B-52 bombers. They need to up the stimulus. They need to up the credit expansion. That's the only solution they have left, Dave, and I think that's where they are going with this.
I mean, don't you think by doing this, I mean, not raising the interest rates, continually manipulating the market, you know, everyone's looking at this saying, okay, the credibility of the Fed now is going down the toilet because we don't believe what they say. And from what we're seeing around the US, with we know the unemployment numbers are completely fake. A lot of the GDP numbers that are coming out are completely revised and manipulated. I mean, don't you think the credibility of the Fed now is not holding at this point and it's going to start to falter?
Well, I think the credibility of the Fed has really never been in place for myself since its inception. It's completely unconstitutional and is one of the pillars of the Communist Manifesto. That said, though, is that look, people think this is the new normal. Clearly, investors and high-frequency traders are buying into the fact that it's not now and likely never in the near future a good time to raise interest rates. So, yeah. I think that they're going to continue with this. And look, the bottom line is these people know this is going to go down in flames. Like you said, though, this is about transferring more power and wealth to that upper tier. And that is what is happening right now. And these are the same people, by the way, that will stand to reap trillions of dollars when this thing goes down in flames. Absolutely.
So you did a video saying that there's going to be a new world currency October 20th this year. And you're saying, you know, this is what's being reported, but you're saying absolutely not, there's not going to be a new world currency. What were you trying to say there about this new world currency? I mean, is
Well,
it coming?
I definitely think the next round, maybe not the next, but in not too distant future, I think that we are going to see a global coordinated economic stimulus. So when you start to see problems in China, in the United States, in Europe collectively, I think the next plan is a global stimulus that completely wipes out any hope of returning sovereignty to the United States. I think that is in the works. I think we're far removed from a global currency, and I think calls for a global currency anytime in October. It's why I put out a video saying I will quit my YouTube channel if that happens. That's how confident I am. That's not going to happen. That's how confident I am that world government's not going to be announced next week or September, whatever. Look, the bottom line is that there's incredibly great and accurate YouTube channels and sources of information out there. Yours is one of them, and so are so many others. But I think at the same time, there's a lot of nonsense out there, and especially during times of turmoil begin to get really bad, Dave, this is when people need to really figure out where they're getting their news from and where they're getting. Look, what I talk about is just my opinion. And I always tell people, don't take my word for anything. This is my opinion based on people I speak to. I believe it, but doesn't mean you have to believe it.
No,
so that's what I think about that.
No, I mean, this is what I'm saying. I look at all the economic indicators. I look at what's going on and I compare it to history. And a lot of these things are starting to, you know, repeat. We're seeing a lot of the same things happen once again. And I think a lot of people are looking at this saying this is a sign that something is happening. Now, of course, as we know, the central bank, they'll do whatever they have to keep this propped up as long as they possibly can. But there's always that black swan. There's always that thing that comes out of left field that they can't control. And I mean, it could be like a cyber attack. It could be war. Where something just happens and they just can't control what's happening here. I mean, do you see any black swans occurring?
You know, I can't pick to any one that I think is coming soon, but I'd say the biggest probability of the next black swan, in my opinion, is some kind of cyber attack that takes down either the power grid or the stock market or the ability for financial institutions to interact with each other. Any of that happens for longer than a day or two, and you have a serious, serious problem, and serious pandemonium and panic that takes place. So really, wouldn't really take much. It's something that really doesn't cost any money for these hackers to do. And look, you know, it's often talked about the Russian hackers, the Chinese hackers. Make no mistake, the United States has the legion of the most sophisticated freaking hackers on the planet. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they're right in on it. They're right in. So, I mean, look, this cyber attack could come from anywhere. We don't know where, and we don't know, you know, certainly there's ulterior motives behind many of the reasons why they would launch something like this. But I think at the end of the day, cyber attack over war is likely more of the, I mean, because this is 21st century. If we were in the 20th century, I'd say, well, yeah, it's war, currency wars. But today it's more so, I think, you know, a cyber attack is really the biggest thing that can cause the maximum amount of damage. With the littlest amount of resources.
I agree with you. I mean, I've been talking about cyber attacks for quite a while. And what's nice where they can use this as a false flag, actually, they can tell you there's a cyber attack. I mean, the banking system, the New York Stock Exchange, you know, they can bring it down. And they really don't have to have any type of proof. They could just say, you know, oh, it's coming from Russia, it's coming from China, and everyone's going to believe this. And there's no damage anywhere in the country. And they can just say, oh, yes, it was them. And now we have to take further steps. And this might lead to war. And they can also say, you know, because they brought down the financial institutions, this is what also brought down the economy. I mean, they can use that for that particular reason.
Everybody will believe them, Dave. Everybody, yeah. Except you and I and the people listening will believe them. I mean, you know, the majority of Americans will believe it, and it's extremely troubling. So yeah, no question about it.
So let me ask you, do you believe there is a collapse coming?
There is no question that this economy and this current business cycle that we are in. I mean, I'm a believer in Austrian economics. The economies for even before this was even that school of economic thought was started has always worked in cycles. We've seen massive amounts of inflation and deflation take place going back to the Romans and the Greeks, and we'll continue to see that. I think we're at the end of this current business cycle. It's going to be one of the largest economic collapses we've ever seen. When that happens, I don't know. Does that mean it's the end of financial markets, the end of opportunity, and the end of the world? I don't believe it is, but there's no question at the rate that they have expanded credit since 2008, the Fed's balance sheet, the derivatives, and everything else, it's a recipe for complete economic disaster.
Well, I'm not going to ask you any dates or anything like that because we don't have crystal balls to look into the future. But what I want to ask you about a collapse, I mean, is this going to be like 2008? I mean, we had, you know, the corporations, the bankers testifying on the floor of Congress saying there's going to be riots in the streets if we don't bail them out. Is this scenario, this collapse scenario coming, going to mimic 2008, or is it going to be not as bad or a lot worse?
Well, you know, in 2008 was mostly the subprime and credit default swaps that were really isolated to a few banks. It just so happens to be the guy that ran the Treasury at the time was a Goldman Sachs operative who lied to the American people, basically saying that Grandma and Grandpa's savings account and life insurance account was going to basically go to zero, which was a complete lie, and the sense has been exposed as such. But yeah, no, it's going to be much larger than just subprime or credit defaults. I mean, we have the potential now for the multiple bubbles to burst, from stocks and housing to derivatives to the bond market to the dollar, to the student loans. So all of these could potentially go down in flames simultaneously, where no amount of economic stimulus or money printing would be able to heal that damage. Because, I mean, you know, at the end, at some point, people will begin to lose confidence in the system if the only remedy for any type of collapse or any type of economic downturn is more monetary stimulus. Eventually, people get that that's not going to work. And when I mean get, I'm talking more about the producers get this. The producers that are out there running the business or that are, you know, have somewhat of an investment acumen. So, you know, people that are out there producing, that are making things, they're going to realize that, look, they can't continue to fix the economy with monetary stimulus. It's just not going to work. There's no historical precedent for it. In fact, just the reverse, you know, things ultimately end badly when governments begin to print money. And, you know, people need to understand the scale of the money printing at this case, the scale of the credit expansion, the scale of the money manipulation has never, there's no precedent for it. It's never taken place at this scale. So, you know, if we understand boom and bust cycles, we know that the booms get bigger, the busts get bigger. So yeah, the bust will be much larger than it was in 2008.
Fabian, one last question here. What will the everyday person actually experience when this whole thing starts to fall apart?
You know, I think we're going to see really high unemployment. We'll see the real number of unemployment. You know, depending on how bad it gets, I mean, it could be, you know, we could have almost like a Greek style situation where people have, you know, things are hard to come by at grocery stores and what have you. This is why, Dave, one of the things that I tell people is we need to go beyond preparations of gold and silver, but preparing ourselves, you know, spiritually or getting your head right to be able to deal with situations like this. I think entrepreneurs and I think opportunity will still exist. That's an avenue that I am exploring, that I go down, that I'm working on. And I think, you know, so yeah, I mean, for the average person that has a 9-to-5 job that's barely getting by, those are the ones that are going to suffer the most. But Dave, those are the people that are going to suffer the most either way, whether there's economic collapse or not, because most of those service type jobs are going to be